95 miles east of Cincinnati on the Appalachian Highway sits the village of Piketon, Ohio. Driving through the area, you'd never realize that nestled in these hills lies one of the largest relics of the Cold War atomic arms race. The Portsmouth Uranium Gaseous Diffusion Plant supplied the United States with highly enriched uranium and was the lifeblood of the surrounding four-county region for nearly half a century. As the Department of Energy and Ohio EPA work to decontaminate and decommission the facility, local residents are weighing in on the eventual reuse of the site. Assisting in this process, faculty and staff from Ohio University's Voinovich School for Leadership and Public Affairs work to facilitate information gathering and idea sharing. Through a process known as Port's Future, the community is shaping how this dormant economic engine can be reignited.
No one truly understood what was being done. No one talked about what they did. They couldn't even tell you what building they worked in. Secrecy during the Cold War was imperative. The community had very little, if any, knowledge at the site.
There's no question there were resident FBI agents. The FBI guy came and filed his reports through the post office. The postmaster made sure we knew that, hey, the FBI guy's leaving stuff in here again.
There's a lot of discussion about that now, about changing the name, getting away from atomic, but you'll never change that terminology to the people, you know, locally.
In early 1956, this huge plant on a 3,700-acre site was in full operation. Few construction projects in history were of this unusual magnitude, a significant contribution to our national defense program.
This is a map of the Ports facility. I don't know if you can see these buildings, X330, X326, X333. These were the huge buildings that were part of the uranium enrichment with the gaseous diffusion plant.
Since uranium contains only one part of U-235 to 140 parts of U-238, several thousand such barriers or stages are passed before the required degree of enrichment is achieved.
My gosh, it's just monstrously huge.
You don't realize how big that is until you stand in there and you can't see the light on open doors from both ends. I mean, it's just huge.
So there's a lot of radionuclide contamination in these buildings. They can't be reused for another function because of that radioactive contamination associated with enrichment.
We're located within about two-thirds of the population of the entire United States, and that site has rail, has highway. I think that the possibilities are wide open.
Their quality of life, in terms of employment and the economy, have suffered.
In the decade following World War II, the United States found itself thrust into a conflict the likes of which the world had never seen. Without a single shot fired, the US and Soviet Union entered into a deadly game of brinksmanship where nuclear annihilation was the only known endgame. Spurred on by the possibility of falling behind in the global arms race, U.S. government agencies and corporations rushed to produce an entirely new industry around atomic energy, a scientific field still in its infancy.
Groundbreaking occurred on November 18, 1952. And that same day, the cats and scrapers churned the landscape to level out the rolling farmland for the building foundations.
There's always been a question in everybody's mind later about why they would choose Piketon. You had an isolated community. You had a geological foundation out on top of those hills, which made it easy for them to be able to come in and construct. But I think the basic thing you had to look at was we didn't understand what it was. You understood this was necessary to fight and help us win the Cold War. At school, we were doing the duck and cover, and you know, we were scared to death, you know, that these things were going to happen to us. So to find that particular combination of people who are going to support this, not because they necessarily even understand it, but because it's a patriotic thing to do.
Down through the years, we've had the steel mill, you've had the paper mill, you had Mills Pride. None of these are the plum, so to speak, the plant carries with it.
Those jobs were premium jobs even at that time. They required more training and more education than it did working in the steel mill or the shoe plant.
And so, as the water vapor rises in the sky, indicating the Portsmouth plant is on stream, let's summarize some of the accomplishments on the project.
Well, it was a great disappointment in 2001 when they ceased operations at the plant. We had lost all these jobs. Working at the plant was a generational job. It's affected all of us, and we have never really been able to find something else to take its place.
Right now, we have double-digit unemployment. We have the 16th highest unemployment rate in the state of Ohio. And that's difficult to deal with because as unemployment begins to run out, people will take any kind of job. And that's what we do in order to feed our families.
What we say is what we use. Red cards or black cards?
We really would like to have jobs that provide the opportunity for people to take care of their families. We do have a lot of social issues here that are barriers to our growth. However, I believe strongly that if we have opportunity here in terms of people being able to survive, being able to care for their families, a lot of the social issues will take care of themselves.
Unemployment, it's, you know, as we all know, it's the number one issue in our country right now. Well, the unemployment rate there is 9.1%, or 9.2% in June. In Pike County, it's what, 16?
You know, the biggest concern everybody's got is jobs.
Jobs.
1,600 jobs.
Good paying jobs.
We still have some manufacturing here. We still have a very dedicated workforce.
Even though the unemployment is so high, there's a strong work ethic in Pike County. One of the most important things my father taught me, whatever shortcomings you have, and you may have, and I've had a lot of them, whatever shortcomings you have, you can overcome that by hard work. Hard work, that's one thing that almost all people will respect. And that's one thing I learned from him.
We have a very good workforce.
From our survey that we conducted in the four counties of 1,000 people, we asked 1,000 people what are the two biggest problems facing their community. 82% said jobs economy from the larger survey.
So that was my concern to come here tonight to see what the future out there is. Because I feel the future is, you know, we all got a lot at stake here because we sure need the jobs. You know, our economy here is just dwindled away. Our jobs, especially our construction jobs, is really hit heavy. And we need to work. You know, that place needs 15, 20,000 jobs right now just to help this area.
So to contextualize the impact that that plant has had on the region, when it was being constructed in the 1950s, the historical records show that there were somewhere in the neighborhood of 22 to upwards of 27,000 people employed. And if you look at the population numbers now, there's 27,000 people in Pike County. They're looking at about 2,000 plus people who are employed at the plant doing decontamination and decommissioning.
We really don't want a contaminated landfill at that facility. I mean, we need to tell DOE we do not want this stuff buried there because we want alternative uses and not just a landfill.
I think we still need to get a lot more kind of understanding of just what the conditions on the site are.
Yes.
To know what, before we start evaluating what's practical and what's not.
Key to the reuse of the site and job creation is the ongoing environmental cleanup known as decontamination and decommissioning, or D&D.
These facilities were not built to be torn down. They were built to operate all the time at a very high reliability. There's a lot of entwining between, as you might imagine, utilities and infrastructure, as well as the hazards or things that we consider hazardous now that were not considered hazardous back when they were built.
They were so focused on enriching uranium, they didn't devote a whole lot, certainly not enough resources and focus on the environmental fate of the wastes. Anytime you handle nuclear materials, you're going to have residue. You're going to need to monitor to make sure it hasn't had any kind of releases. It's a process that requires incredible cleanliness with the materials inside the process.
Cleanliness control was essential, since the process gas is so highly active that it combines and
the parts had to be so clean and so free of any dirt or contamination. A huge amount of these cleaners were used, and a lot of them were discharged into the environment.
Sections of pipe were dipped in chemical reagents in huge cleaning vats to remove foreign matter.
While transuranics and other radioactive elements are present at the site, the primary source of contamination is TCE, a degreasing agent used to clean process components.
The bakery, with the clean floor you could eat off, was nothing compared to Portsmouth. Floors were not only swept, but vacuum cleaned to be spotless.
I don't think immediately there were any health concerns, because remember that the federal government put it in here. They're not going to let anything go wrong. That was strongly in people's minds.
You got the EPA, you got all the regulations and all the safeguards the government puts on that plant. No, I don't see a problem there. I worked there when I was in my 20s, and I'm still here.
I think we all want to make sure it's an absolutely safe environment. That being said, I think that is certainly an attainable goal, and I think that's a goal we should work for.
You know, our mission is to clean the site up, but we want to make sure that we incorporate, to the extent we can, you know, the best interests of the community.
The site-specific advisory board is basically put in place for the Department of Energy to get cleanup levels, so they make recommendations.
The SSAB, the only thing, it's the first time they've ever had such a board in the history of the plant, and it's just a board consisting of local people in the four county area.
There are federal guidelines for establishing advisory groups. We have policy on that. You know, we'd like to have the say of the community. And what better way to do that than establish, you know, a board that represents, you know, a good cross-section of the folks.
I guess I'm a people person. I volunteered to serve on the SSAB. You know, you want jobs, something in the future for your kids and the community. And so I wrote a letter.
I don't know about you, but finding any time to volunteer for something is tough in itself. So they make a huge sacrifice. I don't know, I can't say enough about it. They do a great job. Good, just outstanding folks. If you just step back a little bit and you go, hey, you know, we're gonna clean this place up. You know, we don't wanna do that in a vacuum.
Right now there is a structured cleanup process going on, and hopefully that will remove any doubt in the future.
This more concentrated plume up here, the most concentrated, is from an old impoundment called X701B, and you can see the bright red, the groundwater contamination that emanates from that old pond. There's no silver bullet to address those plumes. There's no super technology that can just go in there and zap it all. So there's a variety of things that can be used out there. One is simply pumping the groundwater and drawing it into wells for treatment, and that's done at a lot of these areas. There's also some interceptor trenches that can be used to try to intercept the groundwater. They've done very deep trenches throughout this area to introduce oxidant and treat that. And that's been pretty successful.
We used to stand here in the garden, and we used to look off in this direction, and we could see, on a good day, we'd see the steam rising over this hill over here in the distance.
I feel really good about the cleanup. I mean, I'm excited that the cleanup is ongoing. You know, I'm more concerned about what's going to be considered for the future. The site is being cleaned up, and so there's an opportunity maybe to do something different.
Ohio University received a grant from the Department of Energy to conduct this broad-based public outreach. The grant was to engage the community and gather their ideas about the future of the site, and then to present those ideas to the Department of Energy so that they could use community views in making decisions about what will happen out there. We designed the project to have three phases. The first phase included a telephone survey, and we did interviews with key stakeholders.
We went to all the county fairs in the four counties. We went to Walmarts. We went to chambers of commerce. We went to farm bureaus, to as many venues, either clubs, organizations, as we could.
So that was phase one, information gathering, getting data that we could use to take us to the next phase, which was the visioning phase.
We are going to begin this evening a discussion about the future of your communities. Our role is to facilitate the dialogue amongst yourselves to make sure that we pull out your best ideas for the future of the site.
The visioning phase started big with a couple of large meetings. We called them kickoff meetings. People were invited to come to talk about the project and to really get started on what's the vision for the future.
Our process is not to put boundaries around what you come up with.
And then from the big meetings, we went to eight smaller meetings, two in each of the four counties, where people at the kickoff meetings self-selected into visioning teams. And they met twice, and they developed some specific scenarios for the future of the site. And then at the top of this triangle, if you think of it that way, there was an advisory group that took those scenarios that were developed at the county level and came up with nine scenarios that they thought represented the work of the visioning teams and the kickoff meetings.
What we want to make sure we communicate is that, public input and participation is really important to us.
My understanding is that at this point in time, things are different with the Department of Energy and just in general with the community being able to have some say about what they want or don't want.
I think the most important thing with what Ohio University is doing is educating the public as to exactly what is there now and what could be there in the future.
It's not just a DOE aid, it's something that the SSAB recognizes and appreciates because they can't go out and talk to the number of folks that the Ports Future survey did. And local politicians will use that. Other business leaders will use that. Union leaders will do that. So, that's available to not just DOE.
I'm not really sure what will come of it, but I hope good things come of it, and in participating in it, I feel like that any opportunity we're given to participate, we need to take. It's kind of sad that there hasn't been more involvement with this big project.
The environment is going to be taken care of. The EPA is going to make sure that everything is going to be safe for the people.
With the cleanup, you mean?
With the cleanup, right?
With the cleanup,
and in the future. I think if they can attract the industries will be here. There's an awful lot of underutilized industrial space in the county. I mean, there's a industrial site half the size of the DOE site, basically right in the town of Waverly. It's completely empty.
Here's Mills Pride. I refer to it as the elephant in the room. That was the largest employer in Pike County at one point. The atomic plant was. The owners sold the particular model of cabinets that they were making. There was no longer a demand. They changed.
And it provided good paying jobs with benefits. And when you lose 1,400 jobs, that has been devastating. And it has moved Pike County up to the highest unemployed number in the state at 15.1. So we have our hands full trying to create and find jobs. SODI is a community reuse organization, and that is our federal designation. SODI's region was developed by the Department of Energy. Over 90% of the workforce comes out of Scioto, Pike, Ross, and Jackson counties. We are trying to make an impact on the lives of the four-county region because of the loss of jobs.
SODI's official role is the community reuse organization, and in many ways they're fulfilling that function for DOE by recycling materials from the plant. I think that's a great function for them. Actually, any kind of industrial stuff that they can get in I think would be great, but with the exception of I don't want to see more nuclear. I really just don't.
ACP has been funded for another 2 years. You have the Dove 6 conversion plant that's dealing with nuclear waste. So they're there for the next 20 to 25 years. The main concern is to what companies will locate next to that. And most of those would be, in any terms that I can see, would be nuclear based.
While most of the A plant site is being decommissioned, two nuclear operations still remain on site. The depleted uranium hexafluoride conversion project, known as Duff 6, takes waste from the enrichment process and separates its component materials into more inert, partially reusable materials. The American Centrifuge Plant, or ACP, represents a smaller, more modern process for the enrichment of uranium than the previous gaseous diffusion.
You know, Duff 6, that's part of our cleanup mission. You know, as we enriched uranium here, we also had waste material as a result of the enrichment process, and so that's about addressing the depleted uranium. They will be here for probably 18 to 20 years to come.
Duff 6 plant out there, because that's a DOE right. site, there is limitations of what you can put next door to it.
But would that be the same thing with ACP?
So that needs to be clarified that we're talking about future scenarios, the entire reservation, including the USEC leased buildings.
So is there are some constraints at the site, and one of them is that there's an American Centrifuge plant.
The American Centrifuge Project, or ACP, is an experimental project using cylinders that would actually enrich uranium. What I know of it right now is they just received another $300 million to do the pilot project here to keep jobs for another 2 years. They have asked for and have been denied to this point a $2 billion loan guarantee.
Things are very questionable as far as what's going to happen with the centrifuge project. We don't know if the loan guarantee is going to come through or not.
A certain amount of protected area.
Yeah, we were not able to get that clarified specifically through the Department of Energy in terms of how much of a perimeter would be off the table. Is that your question?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how much that is, we don't have a specific.
So this is all currently retained lease by USEC.
DOE, we lease, you know, a certain part of the site to United States Enrichment Corp, who have the American Centrifuge Project. That's a private endeavor, and as such, we pretty much stay out of it. So I can't really comment on ACP.
There is one note that existing commitments for the Duff 6 operations in the American Centrifuge Plant render that portion of the reservation exempt. So any scenario cannot include those areas and facilities dedicated to those activities. So that's the only.
I want to ask about that.
Quickly, yes.
You said, and if I can quote you, we can't speculate about the future.
Exactly.
If we can't speculate about the future, what the heck are we doing here?
What I meant was, we can only go, in terms of lease agreements, we can only go with what we know today. This visioning process, as any good process or a strategic planning process should be, is a living document. It's an ongoing document. So those things certainly can and should and would be revisited.
When it comes down to it, though, the advisory group developed the scenarios knowing much more about the ACP, the American Centrifuge Plant, than any of us who coordinated the project knew. You know, they're living with it. They know a lot more about it, and they developed the scenarios based on their current understanding of that facility.
DOE will make this determination. If I had to guess, I would say
the minimum is going to be 700 probably. It could be the entire inside, which would be 1,000.
Whether it stays or goes is something that they talked about at the advisory group, but it didn't really affect their overall scenario development for the future of the site.
And our charge here tonight has been to try to narrow this down to a manageable number of scenarios for the future of the facility that we can then take out to the public.
I wanted to point out for Pike County,
the mixed use, the National Labs in support.
It's a recovery steel plant.
Wellness center.
solar, American centrifuge plant support.
Biomass.
Just a single-use nuclear power plant.
I actually mentioned a prison.
Could have like a nature park.
I think we can look broader.
The multi-use a little bit.
So does it actually fit?
Just change the title to State and Regional Training and Education Center.
These are the main areas that we looked at. I think everybody has them in common.
Most importantly, what's the funding been out here? It's been DOE. And so what would DOE support?
What we're going to do is to actually rate the scenarios that you plan.
Here are the results of your ranking.
This is, at least so far, with a quick tally, how it shakes out.
So we'll take these out to the public. So we're going to go to places like economic development groups, chambers of commerce, county fairs.
Finally, we went to phase three, where we took those scenarios back out to the public at the county fairs, and we did online voting so we could get as much public input as we possibly could on this third phase, which ended up with
one of our other research tasks for this project is to do what we're calling an economic analysis of the future use scenarios, so the nine scenarios that we've got.
This is how the advisory committees ended up ranking the scenarios. And so what our job really is to say, so what happens if scenario A versus B comes in to the site? I still don't know how things might tilt.
There's been a lot of talk about a possible nuclear power plant on the reservation.
We have an ideal opportunity to develop one of the premier energy parks in the entire United States of America. A nuclear power plant has been proposed.
You know, it is what it is, so it ought to go right on and be nuclear power plants or whatever the future holds for us.
I guess if you're going to build nuclear power plants somewhere, that's as good a place as any, better than in an earthquake zone or a tsunami zone.
It's been a nuclear site for 50 years,
yeah.
and the local public has accepted that and hasn't had a problem for 50 years. So I would say that's excellent also.
The groups that they had put together for this visioning had put a nuclear power plant down at number 8, and it come back with the number 1 hits that was online. So that desire to have those good paying jobs is very important.
Yeah, I've been to so many meetings. Yeah, I've been to most of the meetings DOE's had, or USEC's had, or environmental groups have had, and the majority of people who show up are what you just say. Build a nuclear plant, whatever.
I just can't really think of anything that is as uncomfortable or that poses the same sort of risk in my eyes as nuclear.
You know, if something goes wrong, it's usually big.
If I look at the nuclear power plant, I've got total employment of only 840.
Mm-hmm.
But the value added comes in at about 145, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a much different picture from the national R&D one.
Mm-hmm.
And there, I think if I remember the numbers correctly, we've got some, there we go, 255 jobs on average,
mm-hmm.
or 2,055 jobs, and then you've got about 118 million in value added.
This site could become a major research center.
We do not have a national lab, but very much can support the national lab.
This has been a big thing at other places, particularly Oak Ridge.
I think that's kind of unlikely.
Which one?
The national lab.
A lot of our scientists, our engineers have retired, and we need to make sure we're building it back up. And we also can't just look just the next 5 years. We have to make sure that we establish something that goes on forward to the next 20, 30, or 40 years.
It's really more of an education component to it. I think the technology training program was sort of different because in this area, we have a lot of vocational programs, but I think that they could be linked together.
Maybe it's some kind of mix of educational and the research and development. I guess that would be my ideal scenario.
The one actually, and we comment on this, that technically creates the fewest jobs and the jobs don't seem to be that high paying. Actually, it's if it's if it's just education alone. Those benefits don't appear until years later. If you do have education, I think probably it's best to combine it with some sort of industry so that the two have a synergistic relationship.
Within that perimeter road, to me, is a perfect site for an industrial park if it's cleaned up to EPA standards.
That's where we as Americans need to focus, is getting some of those industrial-type jobs back that have left and went overseas.
At the county fairs, I remember a lot of folks coming to the booth, and I would ask them, which are the three that you really like? And several of them would keep saying, oh, no industrial park, because there are plenty that we have.
Sodi is an industrial site. My understanding is that they don't have a whole lot of going on in there, and that they can have a lot more room in there that they could get more stuff going too.
What we see here, we would like, is transportation and some sort of manufacturing. Right now, we're hearing that there's very little interest in this site because of the size, but we're hoping that some sort of distribution type of trucking company, because they have over 100 dock doors, would be interested as a hub for transportation and distribution.
Really, before we get any industry up at the DOE site, I think we really need to get the stuff that's already here full.
Look at the green energy production, bringing in corporations that would do clean energy type jobs, developing different resins maybe for your blades on your wind turbines and different things like that, or something that we're investigating and definitely wanting.
I don't see why we couldn't. I mean, why it couldn't be here? It could be here just as well as anywhere.
We've had solar panel projects interested.
I'd like to see more solar. I think in the long run it would really pay off.
Ohio only has a few locations that solar panels will work, and we're one of them.
We talk about solar and wind and things of that nature, but there may be some other things out there that we're just, at this point, have never come up with.
I mean, I would love to see some renewable energy industry, wind, solar, manufacturing, but you know, I think we need to jump on that now.
DOE is going to be the final arbiter, and what they decide to do may be completely different than what we've said.
Absolutely. Yeah, somebody asked me the other day, well, is this going to make them do anything? I said, no.
Of course not.
Well, no, but it is the only opportunity we've ever been given to say something.
Well, that's the thing.
I would hope that the Department of Energy is, you know, going to take the information and that it's going to have some impact.
Over the years, there's been so many studies done and funded, and they were worried about just another study that would accomplish nothing, that would be wasted funds.
What guarantee or what checkpoints are going to happen throughout to make sure that this is put into, it comes to fruition?
You know, I don't know how you measure tangible results on some of that stuff. You have to measure it over time, right? The best we can do here is, you know, we provide jobs. You know, it's based on the funding that get appropriated from Congress, but we do provide good work. We will incorporate reindustrialization into, you know, the mission here, and that is to the extent we can. And we do continue a lot of outreach.
We cannot be the stewards of this. The stewards of this work are you all. You know, I mean, our job here is to collect and collate.
And where is that going to go? And who's going to monitor that that's going to be actually put into place? I've been asked that repeatedly about this particular project, because now it's almost at the point where we're getting wise.
As part of the site-specific advisory board, we were the ones that really asked for this kind of survey so that we'd have the broad range of four counties at least in the comments. And we will be monitoring it, because we will be taking some of that and moving forward with recommendations.
They will listen to what the public has to say, because they are, you know, ultimately responsible to the public. What I'm hearing is a good thing. We're talking diversity. This has been a, if you will, a one-horse area for 50-plus years, nuclear, and you can see what it didn't get us. And so now we're talking about diversifying into many other areas.
What we're hoping here is we're providing you some tools that you can refer back to when you're talking to these people and saying, we had this broad-based public outreach and all the community is saying this, and here's the documentation of it.
So we hope that you see this as really useful tools.
It was not difficult for us to get people to participate in the project. And I think that has to do with this hope. This hope that that facility is going to stay an integral part of the region and help to improve quality of life.
The plant for this region has been critical. It's created better than living wages, and then people have been able to raise families and send kids off to college.
Family is so important, and the economy is affecting that culture of family.
On the personal side, I wanted to be involved because I have a child and I still coach locally. So a lot of those kids that I deal with, I want to see them be able to have opportunities to stay. It doesn't mean they will, but I'm talking about giving them that choice. Because right now there's not a lot of choices.
Despite their differences, residents of the four-county region came together to create a vision of the future that provides numerous opportunities for growth in the area. It is now up to the DOE, local politicians, and the residents themselves to see these possibilities through over the years to come.
My graduate studies, I lived in North Carolina in the Triangle region, which again was a place where there was absolutely nothing. You go there today, and it's a real metroplex. So I've seen the success stories, and I think that there is a possibility, a very strong possibility, of making this into another success story.
How we make the decisions on what's to take place in the future, well, you have to have vision. You want what the people want. I mean, the people, of course they want jobs, but what kind of jobs, what kind of industry will it be? Nuclear, or will it be wind, you know, renewable energy? And how do we get that information?
And I think what it's done is it's opened a lot of people's eyes of a future that couldn't be bright. And I think you'll see from the study, it does show that everybody finds this to be of major importance. This site has to be used for job creation.
We have a clear vision for what it ought to be. And I think DOE, we just need to make sure that they share that vision, because I don't see an alternative.
I've been very impressed with this process, and I've been very impressed with the interest of the people around these tables. And I just really want to hold someone's feet to the fire about we live here.
That's right.
My hope is that their participation won't be in vain, that the information that we gathered and that we'll forward to the Department of Energy is really going to have a meaningful impact on the decisions that are made. You know, we never made that promise throughout the whole project, the promise of, oh yes, whatever you say, they're going to do, which is amazing that people were still willing to come out and talk about it.
It was visioning. I mean, it's to look far ahead, to see what possibilities, even if they were completely outrageous, it was worth throwing out on the table, because it's a vision. It's the possibility of what could happen. To me, that's what the whole visioning thing was about, it's just about possibilities.
My hope is their engagement, their commitment, and the time that some of the participants throughout the project spent is really going to make a difference to the future of the region.
All of you have been with us, I think, for three of these meetings, plus maybe the kickoff meetings. Your commitment is evident, and so I really, really do appreciate your time.
I second that.
Yeah, we really do thank you for your time.
Thank you.
It's your ideas, and that's what we're really concerned about, making sure it happens.
I'm always looking for ways to get people engaged.
Thank you all so much. Yeah, thank you. It's incredibly valuable.